Well, thank you very much for inviting me here, and thank you, Deborah, for organising it. Lovely to see you again. We bumped into each other about a year and a half ago on the main high street here when I was desperately looking for an eco shop. an hour and a half later, I got there. Before I start sharing with you Ecocide Law, a little something about me. Because I love this idea of provocation. And I think provocation can really elicit something unusual to happen sometimes. And I'd like to tell you a little bit about something that really provoked me in my life. And in fact, I think it really fundamentally changed and kind of determined where my life was going to go. And that was when I was 16, when I was at school in Scotland, in Glasgow. Ian, you probably know this school, St. Aloysius. It's an all-boys school, or it was an all-boys school when I was there, save for seven girls. And I was one of the first seven girls. Now, this was at a time when the using of the leather belt on children had just been banned, had just been abolished. But most interestingly, these teachers who were very used to enforcing a kind of command and control ruling over children through using fear and violence were not given any assistance as to what to do without the leather belt. So very often the next recourse was just to use fists instead, or the fear of being beaten up. And this meant that what we had at school was kind of, well, anarchy, actually. It was, everyone was at war. The kids were at war with the teachers were at war with the kids. And it meant that there was an awful lot of kind of subterfuge and, hijinks happening, trying to see if you could kind of beat the teachers at their own game. And one of the things that we used to do was up in the art room was before the teacher would come in, there would be absolute, it was riotous. Everyone running around shouting and screaming like kids really can. And someone would be on watch out for when the teacher would step back in. But because this was at the top of the building, there were two separate stairwells. And this particular day, the art teacher came up the back stairwell and caught the whole room in action. And in fact, it was two classes together. It was a younger class of 11-year-olds and an older class of 16-year-olds. And here was the thing. The ones of us who were 16, I was one of them, there were very few of us, but there was a class of 28 11-year-olds just kind of running around screaming. And the teacher came in, grabbed the smallest boy, put him on the table, and said, stand on one leg for the whole of the period. 40 minutes. If you put down your leg, I have the right to beat you up. And of course, should you ever try this at home, standing on one leg for 40 minutes is near on impossible. And eventually this little leg came down and the teacher grabbed him in absolute rage up against the wall and was literally just about to punch his lights out when I punched the teacher instead. You're not supposed to clap. The moral of the story is violence beating violence doesn't work. But I can see that might not go down here. But half an hour later, I was outside the school gates. And that was really the end of my auspicious days at a very expensive fee-paying school at St. Aloysius. And I brought great shame on my family. And But here was the thing. That was a provocation to me. I saw something that was absolutely untenable. I saw it as a huge injustice. I saw this little boy who was, a third of the size of this teacher, who had absolutely no way of winning that argument, who was absolutely going to have his lights beaten out of him. And so I intervened in the only way I could, and it had to be a fast disruptor. having a conversation about anger issues with this teacher was probably not going to work. And so I resorted to what I could only do, and that was to resort in kind, if you will. And, well, not so kind, but actually take matters into my own hands. What was so amazing at that time was that nobody saw what I had done as being in any way right. I mean, we can sit here today and laugh and say, yay. But actually, back then, it was really seen that I had done something absolutely untenable, because it was perfectly acceptable, and indeed it was the norm. It was completely normative that the teachers had the right to exercise brute force and violence, or the fear of it, over the children to ensure discipline. That was so deeply ingrained that everyone bought into it, even the children. Even my brother and sister, who thought it was appalling that I had done this. So there was a complete acceptance that, yes, a teacher could punch a small child, but not vice versa. Somewhere along the line, we had bought into this normative that it was fine to use violence against children. Now, that's no longer the case. If you go to St. Aloysius today, they have beautiful anti-bullying mentoring schemes, and it's a completely different world. And indeed, if I talk to my friends' children and say, believe it or not, you know, back in the day, we had teachers that used violence, you know, my friends' children think I'm making it up. They just don't think this is possible. But that's how much things have changed. And actually changed very fast. And indeed, that was a period of transition at that time. I didn't know it at the time, but it led to an investigation. It led to different practices in the school, by which time I was long gone. I was in a different school. But it was the makings of something in me. Inside of me was a very strong vein of standing up for an injustice. And I realized that meeting violence with violence didn't work, and that maybe, instead of using fists, I should find the power of words to do that. So, in a way, it was no accident that I ended up becoming a lawyer. But here's the thing. Once I became a lawyer and a barrister in London, I got to a certain point where I was recognizing that fighting other people's fights wasn't enough for me. What I was seeing was something out there, was a huge injustice happening right across the world. And that injustice was something that we completely treat as a norm. That big transnational corporations can cause significant harm, and indeed you could call it a violence to the earth. And yet it's completely acceptable. How can that be? How is it that we've so accepted this that, in fact, we even celebrate making lots of money out of it? And I'm thinking about the fossil fuel industry, deforestation. You look at the Amazon, for instance, unconventional oil extraction, fracking, huge significant harm. I know from my own direct experience after spending time in North America, in Dakota and Northern Montana, where vast landscapes have been destroyed because of fracking. Unconventional tar extraction in the Athabasca tar sands up in Canada. I spent time there as well, experiencing firsthand whether or not these industries really do cause extensive damage, destruction to, or loss of ecosystems. And one day I got to a point when I was in court and I realized that actually, the earth is in need of a good lawyer. And that was another critical choice point in my life that changed my life, just as it did when I was 16, again when I was 35. Looking out across, I was in the number one court in London, looking across London and thinking, almost like a bird circling up above, and finding my mind wandering across to other territories across the world, that nobody was out there representing the earth. What could be done about this? And that thought fundamentally changed my life. I discovered that I wanted to ask a really big question. And indeed, if you're going to go on a quest, you have to ask a question. And my big question to myself was, how do we create a legal duty of care for the earth? Now, to cut a long story short, what came out of that was me questioning what would bring about a law that could do that. And I couldn't find the answer. I actually went around the world looking to see if there were lawyers out there that were creating a global law to protect the Earth. But I couldn't find them. I could find a lot of lawyers who were discussing it. There was a big discourse around the Earth jurisprudence, if you like. But nobody was actually making the laws. And as a court advocate, I wanted the tools of the trade. Something happened that changed all of that, however. I was up in Copenhagen. I was advising into the climate negotiations back in 2009. And I was invited on stage with George Monbiot. And he and I were waiting for two heads of state to come and join us on stage. Hugo Chavez and Evo Morales. He's Prime Minister of Bolivia. But they got held up in negotiations. And we had 5,000 people who were waiting and waiting and waiting. And unfortunately, there were big bottles of water on the table that we kept on drinking and drinking and drinking. And eventually, you get to the point that you've drunk too much. But we were waiting and waiting. And we opened it up to the audience. And one man stood up and he said, "We need a new language to deal with this mass damage and destruction." And I found myself thinking, yeah, it's like genocide, only it's ecocide. Wow, that should be a crime. How come this isn't a crime? What I did next was I went straight back to London and I started to research it. I treated it like a legal brief. So I immersed myself in this to see whether or not ecocide could be made an international crime. And like all good lawyers, I went back to first principles. I went to examine how did we create international crime? What is there already? What can be done there? And indeed, after 3 months of really rigorous legal scrutiny, I came out and found myself thinking, yeah, this is missing law. There is a missing fifth international crime against peace. We have genocide, we have war crimes, we have crimes against humanity, and most recently, crimes of aggression, which is the precursor to war in times of conflict. So I could see there was missing law, and I could see that the drafting of it was actually quite straightforward. And indeed, that's what I did. I drafted up the missing law, and I proposed it into the United Nations Law Commission. Now, what happened next changed everything, which I wasn't anticipating at all. The Guardian got in touch, and Juliet Jarrett, a journalist there, said, "Look, Polly, we want to put this out there. This is very exciting. Can you get this up on a website?" I had no idea, you know, as a lawyer, you don't know about websites. I had no idea how to get a website up there. And so I asked my web wizard friend, Roman, if he could help me put up a website. And they said, "Okay, we'll give you a week. Is that enough?" "Oh, yeah, okay." And then the next day they phoned and they said, "Actually, we're putting it out today. What is your website?" Thankfully, I had Roman sitting beside me and we were already trying to put this together. And as we were doing this, he was putting in, you know, up on Facebook and putting in various links, and we were doing Google Analytics. And it went absolutely everywhere right across the world very fast. That was a Friday. By the Sunday night, we'd had 28,000 hits on the website alone. So this really was an idea whose time had come, if you like. We could see it was triggering interest, and indeed it elicited a lot of people wanting to get in touch about it from all over the world. One of the people it elicited was a journalist from the Baltic States who had unearthed a document from the United Nations that made reference to the fact that 50 countries supported ecocide as an international crime back in the 1990s. And that it was only 4 countries out of the 54 at that time who were members of the United Nations who objected to it. did I know anything about this? And actually I didn't. I had no idea. My research had not thrown up that this had been under consideration before. So what this led to was a paper trail, if you will, of research which University of London and their students undertook for me, literally going into the basement of the UN and following the paper trail, because all UN documents are number encoded reference. And they went in with that one document and followed and came out 2 weeks later with two lever arch files as thick of documentation that gave us a whole history of ecocide being proposed as an international crime that went back to 1972 and the Stockholm Conference, which I'm sure some of you know was the first ever international conference on the environment held in Sweden. And indeed, Olof Palme spoke at the opening plenary session. He was the then Prime Minister of Sweden, berating the United Nations for dragging their feet on making ecocide an international crime. So I find myself thinking, wow, this is amazing. I hear it has this history going back to 1972, indeed, when the Rome Statute was being drafted between 1985 and 1996, we discovered through the iterations of the drafting, ecocide was included until 1996. And indeed, there was a working group on crimes against the environment where a whole load of UN rapporteurs and representatives and lawyers were tasked with actually drafting the crimes against the environment, which included ecocide. We even have the notes of the meeting where at the working group on crimes against the environment, it was announced by the then head of the working group that ecocide was going to be removed without any reasons being given. And indeed, objections were made at that. It wasn't put to the vote, it was just removed. And indeed, any other provisions were watered down fatally. What we do have left is a very watered down compromise provision under Article 82B, which is a wartime provision, not a peacetime provision. And the word ecocide was removed as well. Now, I wasn't there, so I can't give an opinion, but I can tell you what else we found. And that was records from the UN rapporteurs who were at those meetings. They wrote down what, in their opinion, had happened. And then they put them into the UN basement. They just had it logged in the hope, I presume, that someone would come along, some bright students would come along and find these notes, which indeed we did. And what we discovered was that, in the opinion of the UN rapporteurs, there were four key countries that were involved with lobbying behind the scenes because of key industries to have it removed. Any guesses which countries? Sorry?
USA.
USA, definitely, yeah. Great Britain, yeah. No, Russia. Russia was our starting point. It was the UN rapporteur from Russia, the delegate from Russia, who was the one that made sure it was on record that 50 out of the 54 countries supported it. Weirdly, Russia actually implemented it into their criminal penal code. And now it exists in nine former Soviet states. So Russia was actually very pro this. I remember this was the time of Gorbachev. So, you know, very interesting. But what we did discover was it was Great Britain, yes, it was the US, France and the Netherlands. Yeah, that's what we thought. Oh. But to give this context, it was the mid-90s, and mid-90s was a very key time for a number of key industries. Fossil fuel industry. Does anyone know what's really big industry in the Netherlands by any chance?
Yeah.
And oil. Yeah, so, yeah, you should say that, yeah. Shell. I'm not naming names. You said it. But the interesting thing was in the mid-90s, this is when there were expansionist plans to bring fracking into the fore in a really big way. In fact, there were four places in the world identified for fracking to really rack it up in a big way. So there was the expansion of fossil fuel operations. In America, the UN rapporteurs identified genetic modification. France, it was nuclear issues. GB, we had fingers in every pie, as far as we could see. So this was corporate lobbying behind the scenes that had done this, that had had it removed. And indeed, we only discovered other records just last year where criminal responsibility provisions for states, state criminal responsibility was being drafted at the same time as the International Criminal Court, International Crimes and the Rome Statute. And at the same time as Ecocide was removed from the Rome Statute, it was also removed from state responsibility as well. Absolutely same time, within a matter of weeks of each other. So we think this was really quite a concerted effort to have these provisions removed. Because this is the thing, environmental issues, significant adverse impact to the environment, is at the moment predominantly a state and commerce, a trade and commerce issue. And I'd like to share this with you. This is, I'm just come back from the Netherlands. I was there last week. And something we were discussing, it is called, there are three levels to this. The first level deals with soft law provisions. So it's known as soft law. And soft law provisions are, for instance, many treaties that have no legally enforceable or binding provisions within them. Nuclear non-proliferation treaty. We are signatories to that here in the UK, which basically says we undertake to ensure we no longer proliferate or disseminate and spread out there nuclear weapons. Yet, every year, we hold a big event in the O2 Centre in London, which is basically a buying and selling conference of weapons of mass destruction, which includes nuclear weapons. And indeed, there are industries in the UK that make nuclear weapons. But because it's here in that soft law, there's no enforcement provision. One state could take another state to the International Court of Justice to get a legal opinion on it. But as we're all trading with each other, the chances of that ever happening, and indeed legal opinions from the International Court of Justice are sometimes not upheld, as Japan showed quite recently, then it doesn't get us very far. Soft law is based on goodwill. But if you don't have goodwill, nobody's going to come chasing you. So the next level is tortious acts. It's predominantly governed by civil law. Now, civil law is to do with cooperation. And this is very much to do with trade and commerce. So what we have here is, in this arena, it's often the sanctions. It's to do with regulations, it's to do with sanctions, it's to do with fines. The state doesn't act on your behalf. So, for instance, if a big transnational corporation causes significant harm to your community, you and your community may have to take legal action against that company. But that doesn't stop the company necessarily from continuing with business as usual. And indeed, you may end up with a payout somewhere further down the line, but often it's too little too late. And often communities don't have the financial or the legal wherewithal to bring those sorts of actions. But again, it's dealing with cooperation. And the biggest problem here is that if you have a company that doesn't want to cooperate or is working on a basis of catch me if you can, where maybe you're caught out once every 100 times, then that can be factored in as an external cost where you end up actually as the consumer possibly paying for it. So for instance, if you're looking at illegal logging practices that are then washed through into either given illegal permits or fake documentation so that then it's sold into the international market, that company that's undertaking the illegal logging maybe gets caught out once in 100 times. Either it pays the fine and continues on with business as usual and has just factored it in so that you pay a little bit more on those chairs that you buy from IKEA, or it can just close its doors overnight and reopen the next day under a new name. So this arena only works where there is a certain amount of cooperation, but if you're not willing to cooperate, then it's not very effective. The third tier is criminal law. And criminal law is very different because it's not dealing with trade and commerce, it's dealing with justice. And that's very important here. It's a justice issue because actually it's the state that then takes action on your behalf. And it takes action against individuals, not necessarily against companies. This arena is very limited in its remit. Very occasionally, you may take a prosecution against a director, but when that happens, you're no longer in the realms of civil law, you're into the realms of criminal law. And indeed, very interesting research came out last year from University of Colorado when they looked at the adverse impact on corporations for environmental civil litigation, infringements, breaches of regulations. And what they discovered was that, in fact, it made zero difference. A company can continue on. Indeed, the more infringements that occur, it seems to be the more the company just keeps on continuing. However, as soon as you step up into the world of crime, criminality, and you're prosecuting a CEO, for instance, for fraud, then a corporation will change its structure because shareholders will lose faith immediately, which will mean that the company will start to lose money very fast. Criminal law is something that society at large finds untenable. And this is very important when we look at the environment at large. And I'm not just talking about human-caused ecocide. So what is ecocide? Ecocide is extensive damage, destruction to or loss of ecosystems. That's the definition I've given to it. There are two types of ecocide. There is human-caused ecocide, corporate, largely corporate ecocide. But I'm saying it's a crime. So I'm leveraging out of this arena down here and saying what we already have here is not enough. It's not stopping the mass damage and destruction that we're seeing playing out day after day after day during peacetime. And that we bring it up into the criminal arena. And indeed, not just crime, but also serious crime. Where we do very occasionally have a very limited governance for trade and commerce, for environmental issues that actually is criminal, often the sentencing provisions are so low and are used as a very last resort where you can just fine the company because it's easier to take that route, then very rarely does it step into this arena of serious crime. Interestingly, that's starting to change here in this country. We have some interesting provisions and sentencing provisions that are quite progressive. However, when we're looking at transnational crime, we have nothing. And this is really the missing law. So we have genocide, we have war crimes, we have crimes against humanity, crimes of aggression, but we don't have ecocide. We don't have the criminalisation of the human-caused ecocide, the corporate ecocides. But also there's a second type of ecocide as well. It's not just human cause, it's also naturally occurring ecocide, the rising sea levels, tsunamis, floods. Now, whether or not you call that climate related, climate ecocide, or whether or not you just say, well, it doesn't really matter because it's the evidence of the harm, that's what counts in accord. It doesn't matter whether or not you accept it as a climate ecocide, but let's call it climate ecocide for the moment. What happens there is that at the moment, this is where we are. In fact, you could say the Paris Agreement is very much in this arena here, in the soft law arena. There's very little provision there that makes it legally binding. It's an agreement. It's based on good intent. But if any country does not want to meet its obligations, the sanctions, what are they? Where are they? Where are the provisions within that? They're not there. So how do we deal with that when trade and commerce keeps on causing that corporate ecocide that we know contributes and exacerbates climate change? And this is a huge problem because, of course, the Paris Agreement is a document that shows that we have knowledge. Virtually every country in the world has signed off on an agreement saying, yes, they accept that there is a direct correlation with the escalation of greenhouse, human-caused greenhouse gases, and rising temperature, which leads to melting ice, which then leads to rising sea levels and extreme events playing out in, for instance, the Pacific, where instead of having one tsunami every 10 years, you have 10 in 1 year, cyclones, floods, and so on and so forth. These extreme events, of course, is leading to an escalation in climate refugees, environmental refugees. Now, at the moment, it's estimated that we have about 65 million refugees in the world. By 2050, it's estimated it will be tenfold, 650 million. To give you a sense of the size of that, if you look at, for instance, the largest refugee camp we have is in Cambodia. It houses just 1 million refugees. That was a temporary camp that was set up 21 years ago. And people are now being born and dying in that camp. Do we just build 650 of those camps? This is madness. So how do we get to a way of dealing with something like climate ecocide, which of course there is a nexus between the human-caused ecocide and the climate ecocide. One is exacerbating the other, the human is exacerbating the climate ecocide. And how do we elevate that Paris Agreement up to here so that actually we recognise it as a justice issue, not a trade and commerce issue where we simply hand out permits to pollute and carbon trading mechanisms? Because the earth is not for trading with. And ultimately, at the end of the day, it's not just an existential humanitarian crisis, which is most definitely a social justice issue, but it's also a crisis for the wider earth community. So within the definition of ecocide law, what I propose is that we don't just deal with it on a humanitarian basis, but that actually you're looking at the significant diminution of enjoyment for all inhabitants of a given territory. And if you look at any given territory, of course, it's not just human beings that live there. And that allows you to then start imposing a duty of care and responsibility to the very earth itself. So you could say this is about the rights of... I'm aware when I move in certain places, you can hear me and then it goes. This is the rights of nature. How we give governance to that, how we give governance to human right to life, how we give governance to the rights of future generations. Or do we just simply put in place ticking time bombs now that will play out far further down the road when we're long gone? So this is really about how we give governance to rights, if you will. Rights in isolation is not enough. Your right to life is the most important right that you have. It doesn't matter about your freedom of assembly or of free speech. If someone comes along and shoots you, you've lost your right to life. And that's very important. So important, in fact, that it's the state that recognises it as a serious crime. And indeed, we have not just murder as a crime, but we have offences against the person for actual bodily harm, grievous bodily harm. And then the most serious, of course, is you have manslaughter and then you have murder. If it's on a collective scale, then you're dealing with genocide. And this is where international serious crime comes into play. So at the very top of the pecking order is international serious crime, if you will. The most serious crimes of concern to humanity, the international community as a whole. And here we have it. We have already international crimes that deal with war and conflict and deal with human-to-human engagement. But what about human-to-non-human engagement? Because we're beginning to recognise that causal nexus. Destroy our earth over there, and it has significant adverse impact to people who have absolutely nothing to do with the most dangerous industrial activity in the world. And yet they're the ones that are suffering the escalating sea levels and the rising floods and tsunamis and cyclones and so on and so forth. So there is this interconnectedness here, and we know this now. And indeed, you could say the Paris Agreement is exhibit number one, exhibit A. Now all countries, or virtually all countries, have signed up right across the world to say that they know that there is this connection between human-caused activity and escalating greenhouse gases. So we have knowledge. And now this is very interesting, because 7 years ago when I first proposed ecocide law, I used to say it was a crime of consequence. You didn't have to have knowledge about this, because we weren't really in a position to say that everyone really did believe and agree that we had knowledge on it. It's no longer the case. We've signed an international agreement saying that we have knowledge and we accept that. So to fail to take action is a recklessness. When you have knowledge of something, there is a beauty within it, because it gives you a choice. Do you choose to just accept what is and remain with it? Or do you choose to do something else instead? Now, when I was back at school, I had a choice in that moment. I could have just allowed that teacher to punch that child and allow that violence to continue. Indeed, I was part of that whole system of violence that was happening. But I chose to do something else instead. And I stood up and I took action in a very clumsy way, admittedly, but in the only way I knew that that teacher would stop at that point in time. In effect, what I did was I disrupted a system, a pattern of harm that was playing out time and time and time again. I was a key disruptor in what happened there. And indeed, it led on to investigations and a decision to change policy within that school at a time when it was starting to change, thankfully. But this is what ecocide law does. It acts as a disruptor. And I think this is very important, because we have this knowledge now. 5-6 years ago, I spoke at, there was a shareholders resolution challenge against Shell in the UK. And I went along to that resolution. I discovered my mother had shares in Shell, which she'd inherited. Quite a lot. And I said to her, why have you still got these shares? Well, I make lots of money out of this, of course. And I discovered that, well, actually, I could go in her proxy. So I thought, aha, okay. I will go and I will speak at this AGM that they were holding. And the AGM was held in the Barbican in London, in Theatre Number 1, which is really huge. And here they were, all up on the stage. The stage is really high up. There's a theatre pit. And then I think it can seat about 5,000 people. It was absolutely packed out. Now, this shareholder resolution being organised by Fair Pensions did an amazing job. Very, very difficult in the UK to raise shareholder challenges. And indeed, I think it was the first time it really had been done on such a wide scale. People had been flown in from the Niger Delta to speak. Indigenous people were brought in to speak from Canada, from the Athabasca tar sands, about the harm. And what it was that there was a huge pattern of harm playing out here, where there was, you know, damage and destruction. So the ecocide was happening. And this was leading to conflict. At an individual and community level, but it was leading to resource depletion. We're going downwards, which meant that there was even more conflict arising between the people who were living there. And ultimately, you know, what will happen is it will, you know, once we go to even more resource depletion, we get to war. And indeed, we've already had one resource war over water. So here was this thing, was that there was this huge pattern of harm that kept on playing out and out and out. And I could see that ecocide law coming in would act as a disruptor. It could actually break that cycle of harm by criminalising it. It fundamentally flips the way that we do things. Now, I'm not anti-business. I'm not anti-Shell. What I am standing up and speaking out against is that which causes significant harm at a collective level. And so business that causes harm, that's my issue. But of course, dirty energy can become clean energy if it's given the right international legal framework, if it's given the disruptor that will change and create a level playing field for everyone else right across the board, and that's very important. If you can't actually change your business at the same time as everyone else, your shares will go down. Because remember this, it is the number one legal duty for a CEO and his directors to put the interests of the shareholders first. So you can imagine the CEO and his directors of Shell UK sitting up on this platform. And indeed, we had a big live screen where Shell Netherlands were being live streamed in, where they had the same headache on their hands over in the Netherlands with a whole load of people that had come to speak up about the shareholder resolution that was happening in the UK. And so they had indigenous leaders, they had activists, they had NGO representatives standing up and speaking out. And of course, they'd backloaded it to the very last item on their agenda. And this meeting overran by 2 hours. It was meant to be 3 hours, it ran to 5 hours, because so many people had been promised to stand up and speak out. What started as a 7 minute representation was reduced down to 3 minutes and then to one. And of course, everyone was getting very angry about this. So there was a lot of heat in the room. There was a lot of anger. Now, I thought long and hard about what was it that I could say, given the fact that I knew I would have whatever time I had was going to be reduced down, which indeed it was. What could I say that could really maybe make some impact and act as a disruptor in the way of thinking in the room? And I wanted to ask a question. I didn't want to browbeat. I wanted to maybe present something that could act as an eye-opener. And what I did was I did some research into the Athabasca tar sands to look at the adverse impact on birds. And indeed, the Athabasca tar sands, the Peace Delta, the Athabasca Peace Delta, is home to the four main North American migratory routes for birds, where they stop off in the wetlands in the Athabasca Peace Delta every year as they fly north. That's between 22 and 27 million birds that don't know the difference between a wetland and a toxic tailing pond. And indeed, if you were to land in a toxic tailing pond, you wouldn't be able to get out either. Now, some of these toxic tailing ponds are over 200 kilometres in length, in diameter. They're huge, absolutely huge, and I've driven through that area. And these birds, every year, are landing on it. The Sierra Club and another NGO in Canada had been tracking what was happening there and had a huge body of evidence of the significant adverse impact to birds. So I had this documentation with me. And indeed, the NGO, the bird NGO, had informed me that it had been sent to Shell's offices, to their head offices, and indeed to their CEOs and the directors. They had it even on recorded delivery, which, for those who are the lawyers here, know that in a court of law, that's very important because it's then deemed served. And so here I was presenting this evidence of this harm and saying, does this not beg the question that what you are doing is really significant adverse impact? It's causing loss, damage to, or destruction of an ecosystem. On a size we don't even have the proper numbers of. And does that not beg the question that something has to change? Surely this is an ecocide. This didn't go down terribly well. I sat down afterwards, and it's very scary. It was kind of like being in court number one in the Court of Appeal, where your legs are shaking because you're standing up and you're actually, there's a wide screen, it's being live screened over to the Netherlands, and all you can see in front of you is a huge big picture of your own face. You're looking into your nostril and some people sitting underneath. Very bizarre, surreal experience. And I came away from this at the end of it when these directors and CEOs wanted to get off the stage as fast as they could. There had been 10% of their shareholders had challenged them on sustainability issues. They did not want to deal with this and they were getting off the stage. And I felt very despondent, as did many of the people that were there. And indeed, there was a lot of anger in the room because there were traditional shareholders there who really didn't want to hear any of this noise or nonsense. But as I was going out of the room, something really incredible happened. The then CEO of Shell UK, he jumped off the stage down into the orchestra pit so that he could get up the steps, push through the crowds to come and grab me to the side. And he said, despite appearances to the contrary, some of us really do care. And I knew in that moment he really did care. And that was a really brave and courageous thing to do because he could have been lynched. There were a lot of people who really were very angry at that, whose families had suffered hugely as a result of what's happening in the Niger Delta and the Athabasca tar sands. And he said, I didn't know about this impact on the birds. So I gave him the information and said, there you go. And that's been served to you in your office. That has been sent to you under recorded delivery. But he didn't know about that. Now, he should have known. He's the CEO of that company. He should have known. He should have made it his duty to know about that. But you know what I found out afterwards? I did my due diligence on him and I discovered that this man, in his spare time, is an ornithologist. He cares about birds. You would think he's got a double duty there. He'd worked in the company for 23 years and he did not know about the adverse impact on birds. And this is the thing with ecocide law. Up here, if you have knowledge and you still go ahead, that's reckless. But also in law, it can be reckless if you should have known, but you went ahead. Because you carry the duty of responsibility to make it your business to find out. And indeed, with international crime, it's called the principle of superior responsibility. The higher up you are the chain of command and control, if you're the CEO or the director, then the onus on you is even greater to make sure you find out. Now, it cannot be said by the likes of Shell now that they don't know what the adverse impact is to the climate. Indeed, Shell, like virtually all oil companies, finance the climate negotiations. That's why it stays here in trade and commerce. International crime is not financed by transnational corporations because it's a justice issue. But here's the biggest problem. International crime is seriously underfunded. To get in place a new international crime is going to cost money. And one of the conversations I had when I was over in the United Nations last April, I spoke to one of the biggest international peace organisations and I said, what will it take for you to run with an international crime for the environment, to run with ecocide law? And they said, Polly, this is how it works. We put in place a 10-year project, but this is a political hot potato. We're going to have to start with sustainable development. Maybe over 10 years we can start gently introducing ecocide. But you're going to have to get a wealthy state to pay for this, to sponsor it. Thing is, all wealthy states don't have ecocide. It's the poor states that do. Which of the small island developing states that are most adversely impacted by climate ecocide are going to finance that? They're not. So I think there's a big campaign looming in the wings that needs to be put in place. In fact, I don't just think it, I know it. And there's a whole big plan there that we want to roll out, but it needs funding. So I'd like to leave you with this story, because it is a great story of hope, and I really think it's a fantastic story. And you never know, you might know someone just like this. There's a guy that I greatly admire, Marshall Rosenberg, whom you might have heard of. He was the guy that really advocated for non-violent communication. And very early on in his career, he went to the United States to go around to talk about his ideas for bringing forth non-violent communication. But it was really heavy snowstorms, and he was to get to a town hall in Philadelphia. It took him 3 days to get there. Everything shut down, planes, trains, automobiles. It was an epic journey just for him to get there to this town hall. And when he turned up, there was one person in the hall sitting at the front. It was an old man, very grumpy. And he said to this old man, you know, look, you might as well go home. And this man said, do you know how long it took me to get here? 35 minutes in the snow. I'm here to hear your talk. And so he sat at the front, and he sat at the front of the stage, and he had a chat with this guy for an hour, and he told him his story of what he wanted to do with nonviolent communication. And this guy sat there, just listening, looking very grumpy. And at the end, the old guy said to him, yeah, but you know, how are you going to do this? What's your dream? And he said, well, my dream is to set up a training centre in Switzerland. Oh yeah, and how much is that going to cost? And he said, probably about 3.5 million. And the guy took out his checkbook and said, will four do? And it happened. Should you know anyone like that that could help out? Doesn't have to be that big. Please let me know. Thank you very much.
Hi, you seem to have to fight. I had a phone call about 2 hours before I came here.
Yeah.
From my sister who lives in Surrey.
Yeah.
She and her partner are artists, and they're very involved in the, I think it's Europa, who are attempting to drill for oil on Heath Hill.
Okay. I didn't know the name of the company there, yeah. Right.
Yeah. And they've been involved in that, and they've been legal observers for the camp.
Yeah.
Her partner found out today that Europa had gone to the High Court to serve an injunction on people's listed on this Facebook support group. And if they go within 5 metres of the site, they will be arrested.
Ah.
So you may not see it as a fight, but a lot of companies see it as a fight, and that's how they treat it.
Oh, sure.
And they're very, these people who are not professional testers, they are obviously people who are in the camp that are kind of maybe they love them. But the local residents are now feeling very intimidated, and a lot of them are backing away from it.
Let me explain. This is my take on this. I think this is about the warrior spirit within us. But if you come from a warrior, a position of peace, what you're looking is not to create more conflict, but you're wanting to ultimately to get to a place of peace, then what you're doing is you're standing up. And it's one thing to stand up and stand in your truth and say, no, I'm not going to let this happen. That's very different from actually going out there and using violence against violence. Now, actually using litigation can be a form of violence. In fact, in America, it's known as slapping, strategic litigation against public participation. So you're an activist and they'll slap a litigation or a lawsuit on you. Or what you do is you use the criminal system so that you position protectors as those who are being the ones who are causing the harm. Whereas in fact it's not, it's here, you know. So there's this kind of corporate hijacking of the system as well that's happening here. And this is the interesting thing with Ecocide Law. What it does do is it reverses that, because then it's protecting, because the state has to act on your behalf, you see. And once you have Ecocide Law, then you as the whistleblower, the community that's saying, no, this is going to be an ecocide, then the state has to come in and prosecute those who are wanting to go ahead with the ecocide. But at the moment, we don't have that law. For instance, I was in Canada a few years ago when, under the previous administration, a whole raft of environmental legislation had been removed overnight. 700 pages of it had been removed by Harper. And indeed, he'd repositioned activists to be termed and as terrorists, so that terrorist legislation could be used for activists. So this is this thing, and indeed what was behind that was trade and commerce lobbying to use criminal law for that purpose. So we have a huge problem here, because who is it that's actually financing law today? You know, a lot of the law that's put in place is because of the commercial world determining what's wanted. In America, the Halliburton loophole was used, it's the name that's used for the legislation that basically overrode all environmental laws for purposes of fracking. Halliburton is a huge infrastructure company, which actually is also huge over here for fracking purposes as well. And indeed, our Infrastructure Act is a form of a lesser version of the Halliburton loophole. So we have huge problems here where those who have the most amount of money are paying for the laws that are put in place, or the removal of the laws that we don't want. So yes, I am advocating stand up and speak out, without a doubt, and I think that's hugely important. And indeed, I think it takes huge courage when you're on the front line. so much more so than just being a lawyer standing, talking, you know, intellectually about these things, that actually when it's your community that's under threat, it's very important to stand up and speak out as protectors. You know, that really is a true warrior's calling, to stand there and say, no, I'm not having this, and absolutely refuse to allow that to happen. But of course, the thing is, it's like fingers in the dike. You might manage to stop it over there, but it's then popping up over there and there and there. And unless you actually have a legal forum in which the community is protected by the state and evidence can be brought forward to see whether or not it is an ecocide. But of course, if it's not going to cause any harm, then there's no problem. That company will have nothing to worry about. But when you start to look at the cumulative impact, and of course, here we have a government that wants to roll out 30,000 wells right across the country, that's a significant adverse impact. And we can bring that evidence from America and from Australia to show what that significant adverse impact is. But at the moment, a council meeting deciding on planning applications, they're being informed that they must not look to the adverse environmental impact when they sign off on those planning applications. So we have a problem here when we have our own government that's not even on the side of the communities and not even allowing something to be put in place so that proper consideration can be looked at to look at that adverse harm. That's where international law comes into its own, because then it becomes legally binding right across the signatory states of the Rome Statute. Yeah, my heart goes out to her. You know, this is a hard one. More and more communities in the UK are going to be looking at this. Yeah, I know this.
Yeah. I'd like to make two points, please. The first is, how much does divestment help if we can lower the value of fossil fuels by getting everybody we know to transfer to a green energy provider? Does that help?
Yeah.
And the other one is, do you really have hope? How long do you think we've got?
Okay. Okay. Divestment. Yeah, that definitely assists. And indeed, in America, there's been quite a big shift for divestment. I was talking to a guy in America about this, and he was saying, problem is, Polly, the renewable energy sector is so tiny, in truth. That there's only so far you can go with divestment until you actually get the infrastructure in place, until you get the scaling up. And indeed, you're not going to get escalation of scaling up unless you've got the laws in place. But then if you've got a state that doesn't particularly want to move in that direction, you're going to require it at an international level, because those companies are transnational corporations and they're not wanting to move if they can still make lots of profit over here. So this really is about, where do you find that key lever that acts as the disruptor of the existing system? And that's where ecocide law is really very powerful. Hope. It depends on which day you talk to me, I suppose. I know in my heart this is going to happen. And indeed, in the legal world, you know, this is progressive law. There is an inevitability about it. And in fact, if we come back to this here, this pyramid of governance, inevitably it will step into this space. However, I think actually we're dealing with having to take more unconventional routes now. If we leave it to the conventional system, it's going to be a go slow and will probably be watered down and become rather ineffectual. And indeed, we've seen this with crimes of aggression, which was a rather ineffectual last minute watering down that happened there, which has created huge loopholes and so on and so forth. So how do we ensure that by putting in something that truly is social and environmental justice, that it's upheld at the high standard and then the governance system as well? I think there's a fast track. In fact, I know there's a fast track to move very fast with this. An amendment to the Rome Statute is actually a very straightforward process, relatively speaking, as opposed to international climate negotiations, which is marred in a whole level of complexity that's, you know, just slows everything down. And indeed, 21 years on, and we're in a worse position, not a better position. But international criminal law requires just one head of state to propose it in. And then it's tabled, and then it's a matter of signatories accruing. So once it's announced, everything moves very quickly. Crimes of aggression, it was just a 2-year process, in essence. And indeed, this could be very fast moving as well. I'm very keen that we don't just have one, you know, sinking small island developing state that just gets thrown out of the water on this, metaphorically, but we actually have resilience and that we bring a unified block of like-minded states to take this forward. And there are a number of states who are interested in this. So, but we have to create a safe space for that to happen, and we have to create the financing mechanism for that. And I think in modern day we can do that. We don't have to rely on government financing, and which then comes from corporations, to do this. We can actually take this into the world of global citizenship and those who care, who can help take this forward. We did a bit of, I've been having meetings recently about this, and we've done a kind of back of the envelope calculation of how much we think this might cost to do. And in truth, to actually get a campaign in place and up and running that becomes self-financing, we think is only about £2.3 million exercise. That's nothing. If you look at the cost of big blockbuster films, we are looking at $500 million or what have you. This is really pennies in the ocean, so to say. But without the financing of this, it remains in the hands of the major state players who have vested interests to not let that happen. So I do think, in fact, I know we have a fast track route. I just need to find, I don't know, if any of you have seen Star Wars, the latest Star Wars film, Rogue One, we're looking for the rogue Rebel Alliance, the rogue funders who can help put together the Rebel Alliance who can take this forward. And we're planning. We know how to do this. We've already got the Rebel Alliance building in the sidelines. Just need that guy in America. Or a little bit of it.
A question about something that is going to become a much bigger part of UK existence post-Brexit.
Yeah.
Which is international trade agreements.
Yes.
TTIP.
Yeah.
TTIP and yes. The Canadian agreement, which will be creating big space for multinational corporations to engage with government out of sight,
yeah,
in a way that makes Europe look positively glowing white.
Yeah.
How do you think we can most effectively make sure that those agreements don't undermine our ability to fight for climate justice?
Yeah, and this is really important because, again, this comes back to this governance pyramid. There's a hierarchy of law as well. International crime supersedes all other law. So you can have an international trade agreement, but if underneath that there's a company that says, okay, we're just going to go and gas everyone in Plymouth so that we can then, you know, start building some big nuclear power stations, well, that would be genocide. And because we're signatories to the Rome Statute, then obviously the state would have to intervene and there would be prosecutions if that went ahead, or there was an attempt to go ahead with it. And that's very important. Even if that transnational corporation turned around and said, well, under TTIP or what have you, we have an agreement going on because we're trade and commerce, that international crime supersedes it. So this is why international crime is so important with regards to something like that. With Ecocide in place, the first and foremost, the boardroom will be, is this going to cause an ecocide? If so, we can't go there. Rather than, is this going to maximise our profit? And if that country is going to be difficult about it, can we take them to some arbitration tribunal behind the scenes and penalise them for it? So this is very, very critical. It is a justice issue, and I keep on coming back to this, that it's about justice. Because at the end of the day, if we don't have justice behind us, then society suffers. And that's why we have criminal law. It's the criminal justice system, you know, and it's called that for a reason. And this is about how actually now, I mean, we are dealing with the crimes of the 21st century, and they are peacetime crimes. We don't have to go to war to cause mass damage and destruction and for millions of people's lives to be adversely impacted as a result. So very important that ecocide law is put in place to supersede and actually take the most adverse impacts out of all these closed behind door systems, which of course is so last century. you know, in this modern day, transparency and accountability really should be at the foremost of everyone's decision-making processes. And indeed it is for those who have goodwill and good intent. But for those who don't, no. They want it behind closed doors, of course. Yeah.
There's a question over there. Yeah, hi there. I have a problem with Ecocide in that you want certainty in law. And you don't quite often know you're going to create Ecocide until after the event.
Yeah.
So it's easy once you've created your 200-mile lake and birds dropping it and dying.
Yeah.
But until that's happened, you don't know. For instance, the oil dealing, I also come from Sussex and we protested. But actually, we all want to use oil. But companies will claim that they're doing it in a responsible manner. Yeah. And it's not until an accident or a disaster happens and then there's environmental damage. How do you sort of compensate or look at that?
Yeah, now, this is to do with knowledge at the end of the day. Either you knew or you should have known what the harm is. And indeed, if you look at oil extraction processes, we know we can actually do a consequence analysis. What's very interesting is with environmental impact assessments today, they're very poorly regulated. So environmental impact assessments often by oil companies, for instance, you can have one environmental impact assessment to cover, say, 500 wells. Indeed, the Deepwater Horizon oil spill had one EIA for a 700 square kilometre area of sea, which had over 500 wells in it. And that environmental impact assessment said three times within it, the risk of anything going wrong is so small that we don't have to think about plan B. That was a risk analysis of something going wrong. A consequence analysis is saying, even if the risk is so small, when it goes wrong, it could be this big. So you look at the consequences. And this is the thing, at the moment, most of these companies are not looking to the consequences until it happens. So Deepwater Horizon oil spill was a very interesting case in point, where actually BP didn't know what to do. And indeed, it took 3 months to work out what to do with that, because there had been no prior planning. What if this all goes wrong, poof, when we're in the middle of the sea? What do we need to put in place that are safeguards for that moment to catch it so that it doesn't go wrong? And indeed, there were financial shortcuts happening there so that there was no safeguard and checking in place. And it was a disaster, a huge disaster writ large. When, back in 2011, we held a mock ecocide trial in our Supreme Court here in the UK, where we road tested ecocide law to see if it would work. And we had a proper prosecution team, proper defence team. Prosecution was headed up by Mike Mansfield QC, who's one of our top human rights barristers. We had a judge, we had a jury, and we used real live ecocides. So we were looking at the Athabasca tar sands, and indeed we built on the evidence that I'd taken into Shell, the dead duck case, if you like, is what we kind of nicknamed it. And in fact, there had been a prosecution in Canada for that. The Sierra Club had used that very evidence that I'd put forward subsequently to take action. But the problem was, even though they brought a prosecution, it wasn't deemed serious crime because the provisions were so low level that, first and foremost, even though it went through as a prosecution, and amazingly the company they prosecuted fought it, even though it was really definitive evidence, when they were found guilty, the starting point, the entry point, was to fine the company. And it worked out at a fine of, I think it was £380,000, which to a big transnational corporation is peanuts. But what we did was we acted as if ecocide had been made an international crime, transposed into national law. So we drafted up legislation for the UK as if it was being put in place. And we road tested this. We used the birds very specifically because there was a lot of evidence and it allowed us to test a lot of different issues to look at that. And it allowed us to bring evidence that was in the public domain out into the press, into the mainstream media, so that they could see how this would play. The only thing we didn't have for real were the CEOs. We did actually get in touch with BP and ConocoPhillips, which was the other company that we were putting the mock prosecution to. But they didn't get back to us when we invited them to stand in court on this. So our actors, we didn't script them. We just said, okay, immerse yourself in the knowledge of who these people are and act as if you would for them. And that was really helpful. And indeed, one of the guys, he actually looked like the CEO of ConocoPhillips. And he thought we'd taken him on for that reason, but we didn't even know that. So it was really strange. But it was about knowledge. You know, what do you do when you have the knowledge? Or what do you do when you should have had the knowledge? Because the evidence is so extensive and it's there. And that's the thing with Ecocide. Actually, often you can actually even look to aerial photographs to understand the extensive damage to a lot of ecosystems. Ecocide is often very visible once you start to go in or look at it. Not always, but often it is. And you can bring evidence of the toxicity of soil samples, for instance, or water pollution or atmospheric pollution. You can bring definitive evidence here. And that's the thing with Ecocide Law. It gives you the forum to examine that. Now, in the instance that you have no knowledge that there could ever possibly be harm, then you maybe have a defence. Because that's the thing, if it's a crime of recklessness, it's either that you knew there was a harm or that you should have known. It's either a subjective test that you knew or an objective test that you should have known because there's so much evidence out there. And if you can prove, actually, nobody would have known about this, then fair enough, that actually could be a valid defence that you can bring forward. But if you look at many of the industries today, there's a plethora of evidence that can be brought to the fore. The important thing is it gives you the forum to examine it. It may well be that actually your particular company is using really great innovative technology, as we discovered with ConocoPhillips in the Athabasca tar sands. They're using far more innovative technology, or they were 5 years ago when we tested this. But they were still causing a significant adverse impact. So even the innovative technology wasn't actually really getting them any further along the road of mitigating the harm. But you never know. It may well be that your company, EcoGreen, what have you, is. And the beauty is you can bring that evidence into a court of law and say, see, we are not causing that harm. And it's been properly tested. At the moment, that community that are in Sussex, or Surrey, you know, they can't have that case brought to have the evidence tested. That's the problem that they hold at the moment. So it's really about how you create a forum so that you have proper testing of evidence to ensure that collective harm is not occurring. And if you genuinely didn't know, and if there genuinely was no way that you could have ever known about that, then you probably have a valid defence there. Yeah. Yeah. But if you look at, for instance, nuclear industry, ticking time bombs for future generations, what would be the decision there? Interesting. That's where Ecocide case would be most interesting, to see what evidence could be brought to show that there could be significant adverse impact for future generations there. Therefore, should we be continuing with that industry? At the moment, we can't even ask that question in law, and that's a problem. Yeah. I hope that helps.
That's interesting.